Okay, it's my great pleasure to present our next speaker, Wojciech Zaremba. He is currently working at OpenAI, and he used to work at Google Brain and Facebook AI Research. So let's greet Wojciech.
Great, thank you for inviting me over here. I'm going to present my work from both of these organizations, from Facebook AI Research and Google. First of all, I'm going to present a very short video which will give you some overview, and then we'll go in details. So here is the video.
Learning simple algorithms from examples. The controller interacts with the environment through predefined interfaces. An example of an input interface is a one-dimensional tape of symbols. The controller accesses a single location on the tape at a given time, as indicated by the yellow box. The interface exposes two actions, move left and move right. Here we see the controller requesting the move left action, and now we see the controller executing the move right action. Another example of an input interface is a 2D grid of symbols, with actions move up, left, down, and right. Another class of interfaces are concerned with output. An example is the 1D output tape. The controller can write to this tape one symbol at a time. It also has a NOP instruction when no output is written. During training, we provide patterns on the input interface, target patterns on the output tape. The controller is a parametric model that learns sequences of actions that produce the desired output. We do not tell the controller the sequence of actions required to solve the problem, thus it has to learn solely from pairs of input and output symbols. It does this using reinforcement learning. The model receives a reward if what it writes on the output tape matches the target symbol. Here we illustrate the overall system on the reverse task. The model has to first learn to move to the end of the sequence without producing an output. Then it must move backwards, copying the symbols from the input tape to the output tape. We have trained our model on multiple tasks. Copy task. The model has to learn to copy symbols from the input interface to the output interface. It solves this problem with 100% accuracy after less than a minute of training. Reverse task. After 2 minutes of training, the model solves this problem. Addition task. The model has to learn how to add two multi-digit numbers. The full algorithm involves memorizing how to add digits, knowing where to look, and taking care of a carry. At the beginning of training, the model struggles with the task. Here we see that it executes the wrong sequence of actions, but by luck, it guesses the right answer. But since we do not supervise the actions, the model receives a reward anyhow. On this example, it executes the right sequence of actions over the input grid, but writes the wrong symbol to the output tape. Consequently, it receives a negative reward. After 10 minutes of training, it solves many examples correctly. However, it is still far from perfect. After 20 minutes of training, it is able to solve very long sequences, like this 5,000-digit example. It also succeeds on corner case examples that we have tried. Three-number addition task. Learning the addition of three numbers is quite challenging. We had to use a curriculum that provided simple examples at first. At the beginning of training, we present examples that involve small digits. It takes 1 hour of training for the model to succeed on this task. The model solves corner case examples correctly. Multiplication task. The last task is to learn multiplication of a single digit with a long number. It takes 20 minutes of training before the model can solve this task.
Okay, great. I hope you could hear what I was just presenting. So let me start the presentation. So, I mean, that was just an overview of what I will be speaking about. I will describe model quite carefully, and also I will relate it to some other models. So this work was done while I was at Facebook and Google. Currently, I'm at OpenAI, but none of this work is from OpenAI. OpenAI is quite a recent organization. So the motivation is that, I mean, as you have a model that cannot interact with external world, such a model won't be able to solve many problems. And you can see that even in the case of human, we have external interfaces to sense data, to sense information from outside world. So for instance, there are eyes, hands, they are examples of external interfaces, and they don't contain the learning parts. The learning part is the brain, and brain uses these interfaces and learns how to interact with them. And quite important thing to notice is that quite often interfaces that are interesting, they are actually there is no way to backpropagate through them, and they are discrete. So for instance, can imagine that actually Google search engine is an interface. So you can type text and you get some answers from it, but there is no way to backpropagate through Google search engine. Similarly about the database. So let's say you can issue some query that would give you some answer, but there is no way to backpropagate through it. And these interfaces indeed are discrete. And in that sense, you can see that such a models, they follow the controller interface paradigm. So it means that there is some learning part in the middle. It's called controller. Controller, let's say, gets the state from the previous time step and produces a future state. In the same time, controller also consumes the information from input. This might be some readings. Output interface might also provide some of the input. So for instance, output interface might tell you if you generated correct answer or what was the content that you previously wrote to input interface. Then you have a memory interface that can tell you about the current memory location or so. And then you're supposed to write to these interfaces. So in case of input interface, can define how to move. In case of output interface, let's say what to write to output interface. And in case of memory, maybe what to store in memory. Or if it would be, let's say, Google, then you could decide what to write to Google. And input from Google would be the text coming from Google. So you can notice that many of the contemporary models, they have actually constant running time, and they have no external memory. So for a given size of input, RNN or the convolutional neural network or feedforward network, they have the same fixed running time. And indeed, they are not able to solve any problem that requires more steps than linear. So for instance, multiplication. I mean, multiplication can be solved in n log n operations, but it cannot be solved in linear time. It actually turns out that by just providing model memory, external unlimited memory, and letting the model to have arbitrary running time, actually that gives a lot of expressiveness to model. That makes already model Turing complete, but it's not necessary. Such model won't be necessarily trainable. So let's say we can make our model extremely, extremely powerful, but it won't be trainable. So in principle, I believe that future models, they will have to be Turing complete. They have to store some of intermediate information in memory. They have to be able to compute for the for number of time steps before they decide when to stop. So I want to emphasize that actually many of previous models, they follow the same paradigm. Controller interface paradigm. So, for instance, one of the first models like that was the neural Turing machine. So neural Turing machine has a continuous memory, which is differentiable. So here we are quite interested in discrete memories, in discrete interfaces. There are some examples of continuous interfaces that people considered before. There is so that was by Alex Graves. There is StackRNN, where people consider continuous stack, and that's actually work by Thomas Mikolov and Armon. Then there was work by Ilya Suskover on neural random access machines, where he used entire gates like addition, subtraction, multiplication as interfaces. So model itself decides how much to use subtraction, how much to use multiplication. You can think that memory network also follows paradigm, controller interface paradigm, when the attention over the input is the interface. And RLNTM, about which I will speak also later on, it uses tapes as interfaces. So first of all, as I said, I mean, interfaces, they can give you a lot of power. You can become Turing complete if you have sufficiently expressive interfaces. But the problem is, are you still able to train such a model? Maybe it's so non-convex or it's so difficult that you won't be able to train it. So first of all, we wanted to investigate if it's even possible to train such a models if we would give solutions. So you can notice that in our problems, like for instance in reverse or in any of problems, we just would give pairs of input and output. So how looks the input and how supposed to look output, and the model has to figure out where to look and so on. But first of all, in order to verify that the problem doesn't lie in expressiveness of our models, we wanted to see if we can train our models while providing actions. So that's the first part, is training with supervision. So as we have tasks like copying, reverse, or walk, they pretty much generalize to 100%. But then as we looked at the more complicated tasks, like let's say addition or three rows addition or single digit multiplication, it was actually a little bit worrying for me that even though we trained it on sequences of the length 100, then as we went to sequences of the length 10,000, many of them failed. Even in case of reverse, you can notice that actually they failed. So there are like various colors. Those are various models that we considered. Those are like a GRU and LSTM. So, I mean, that was in the first place surprising for me that even when you train on the length 100, they won't generalize to length 10,000 or to arbitrary length. You would expect that if model knows an algorithm, then it knows it for any length of the sequence. So we wanted to also kind of examine the breaking point when to understand better at which moment, when, why actually these models, they stop working all of a sudden for longer sequences. So as model does the prediction, we can look at the confidence. And here we show confidence for actually while solving reverse task. So initially, as you are solving reverse task, you're supposed to go to the right, to the right, to the right, until you hit end of sequence character, and then you're supposed to switch completely and go to the left. So if model has no access whatsoever to the past memory, such model as a feedforward network, it can completely solve this problem. And feedforward network essentially won't be able to distinguish if sequence has 100 elements or 1,000. It just sees the current element. Then in case of LSTM, you can notice that first of all, like a few initial steps, they are kind of different for the model than the further steps. It's the model can distinguish. The model is saying, oh, that's the step number one, that's the step number two, that's the step number three, what's the behavior for such a state? And then at some point, it doesn't distinguish states anymore. And you can see that the transitions are less sharp. So green is the color to indicate moving to the right. Red is the color to indicate moving to the left. And that's the reverse task. So we also looked at the hidden state of the LSTM. And you can look at the autocorrelation of it. So as you have, let's say, consecutive states, so let's say we have 35 on this picture, then you look at the correlation of state I with state J. So what happens is you can clearly see that in case of feedforward network, you have two quite distinguishable states. So that's the upper left corner, that's one state. And then lower right corner, that's the second state. And they are completely distinguishable. Then in case of LSTM, the border is more vague. And the model essentially encodes intermediate states. So kind of you can think that the reason why big models might fail is as they are trained on some sequences, let's say they are trained on the sequences of the length 10, 20, 30, let's say 100, and they never seen a sequence of length 10,000, then they kind of, that's data quite out of the distribution. And what happens is, even though number of examples when you have a length up to 100 is huge, then still number of examples for a given for different lengths is relatively small. So also another way of thinking about the problem is that actually here we wanted our model to learn an automata. So the proper automata is at the very top. So the automata would be keep on going to the right, and from the state going to the right, you can once again come back to the state going to the right. And if you hit the end of sequence character, then you should start going to the left, and then go to the left, go to the left. But model instead can learn automata, which is actually incorrect. So it can maybe start distinguishing states, go to the right. So in the sense, then you can either from first time step go to the second time step of going to the right, or maybe you will go to the left. So and the model learns actually might learn blown automata. And here you can see that in case of feedforward network that has no memory and information about the past, you can clearly see two states as at the picture at the top. And in case of actually LSTM, all of a sudden it distinguishes these initial states. It turns out that first of all, as you have model that can have a long memory, then the problem is that such a model obviously can overfit, and then as you would like your training to consist of, so let's say ideally you would like your training to consist of extremely short sequences, because only in case of very short sequences there is a hope that the model would discover what's the proper sequence of actions. But when you have models that have a lot of memory, then they might actually end up learning wrong algorithms, or they have just to have a trouble learning the proper algorithm. And as I said here, overfitting doesn't have the happens with respect to sample length. So even though you will have a tremendous number of sequences that have a given length, like 100, there are like billions or more sequences of this length, but the number of possible lengths is short. There is just the length 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 100. So the model might expect samples to have a given weight. So one of the conclusions is that actually previous interface controller models, as you look into the literature, they are extremely tiny. So I have seen people training, let's say, for instance, Stack RNN has 30 units. And in case of NTM, they were not able to train it with the even classical LSTM. Like LSTM had too much memory capabilities, and they had to actually cripple it to get some weaker model. So in the sense, it's interesting to ask the question how to even train big models for algorithmical tasks. So we would like to provide very short sequences of problems because there is a hope that the model can randomly guess actions and learn. But if we have big models, then they all of a sudden they start distinguishing things that should be the same. So that was quite interesting, but the question is how to train such a models when there is no supervision over actions and how far we can go. So here I will present training such a models with algorithm called Q-learning. And so as I mentioned, there is no supervision over actions. We only provide input and output pairs. So it would mean, for instance, for addition that there is an input which is agreed, and we say what should be the result, but we never say how to move around. So Q-learning, that's the reinforcement learning model, and Q estimates the sum of the future rewards for a given action and a given state. So state, in our case, that's actually entire hidden state of the neural network, and of the neural network. Then action, this is, for instance, either to move to, let's say, as we have agreed, to move up, down, left, or right. And also, action consists out of the information if you should write to output tape or not. So this is a little bit similar to, or I would say it's quite similar to DQN by DeepMind. And we give a single reward if a given single prediction is correct. So let's say if we would have an addition task, let's say what's the result of adding 20 to 25, at the moment when model already would tell us, so let's say the model actually predicts number from the back, if the model would say that 20 plus 25, if it would start saying it's 5, then we would already give a reward of 1. So at the very bottom, there is a there is equation for Q-learning. So equation is saying that essentially current value of Q should be updated as the previous values, previous value of Q modified by alpha, which is the learning rate, and here is the, like, in the brackets inside, there is the choose interesting part. So it's saying that Q learning should aim to match the current value of Q with reward and what is the possible best future reward. So you can imagine that the sum of future rewards, it should have a property that if you take a next reward and what's the best possible reward that you can achieve, then they should be equal. That's the update rule for Q-learning. Actually, indeed, Q-learning is kind of magical. So, Polysim, the way how we behave using Q you're learning, the policy induced by Q is the one that gives you the highest future reward, and that's essentially just argmax A of Q, argmax over actions. During training, you cannot only follow such a policy, because then you would end up actually visiting very small number of states, and usually people use something called epsilon greedy. So let's say with 5% probability, they choose randomly action, and with 95% probability, they choose action according to argmax. And also a little bit of one more thing is that the policy that is induced by Q, we can call it online policy. And if we follow different policy, we can say that we are off policy. So then, very magical thing about the Q is that Q actually converges to optimal Q, regardless if we are on policy or off policy. So you can imagine that as long as you are actually visiting every state action pair, then the Q that you will learn just by using the rule from the bottom of this page, that will be Q for optimal policy. So that's a little bit magical. It turns out that as we implemented the classical Q learning, it didn't work that well. And we had to do some hacks here and there. So people actually developed many tricks how to improve Q learning. So one of the tricks is called Watkins Q Lambda. So to give you intuition. So classical Q learning is trying to match a given Q with a reward plus max of the Q from the next time step. But it turns out that it's completely fine to collect multiple rewards over the trajectory. And then there is a rule how to actually use this intermediate, these multiple R, and together with estimate on Q in order to get better better Q over here. And I mean, I could go a little bit into details, but in the sense, the reason also why Watkins Q Lambda worked well for us is that in our setting, actually, meaning of reward might change over the time. So in the sense, we are in non-stationary environment. It means that that at the very beginning, so reward is given only when the model makes the correct prediction. And you can imagine that at the very beginning, model won't make correct predictions that often. And later on, it will make predictions much more frequently. So you can notice that actually that's the non-stationary environment. And Watkins Q Lambda kind of uses way more extensively rewards over the value of Q. And rewards are something what comes from the contemporary environment versus Q, which is something what was learned in the past. So Watkins Q Lambda more supersedes the current environment over the past environment. So that was one of the, let's say, tricks that we used to improve our learning. At the end, I will show tables to indicate what's the performance gain by the given method. Another trick is we called it the dynamic discount. So one of the problems with actually asking model to predict some of future rewards is that model, there might be no way to determine the sum of future rewards. Like, for instance, if you have a sequence of the length 100, then for reverse, then the sum of future rewards is 100. But if the sequence has a length 50, then sum of future rewards would be 50. So or like in the best possible scenario. So how model could even guess one of these numbers, as it is at the very beginning of prediction? And the answer is model won't be able to do it, but it's possible to just reparameterize the estimate. So we might ask Q to not predict the sum of future reward, but sum of future reward divided by number of symbols to predict. So in the sense, in both cases, when the sequence has a length 100 or sequence has a length 50, the best Q, the Q hat would be 1. So you can imagine it's way better to be in the position that you are asking model to predict the same values rather than to distinguish things which are not distinguishable. And I want to make sure, are you guys still over there? Hello?
Yes, yes.
Oh, okay, cool. Great. Let me go back to the presentation. Another quite important thing already with these problems is that we had to provide a curriculum or like another name for it is that's essentially incremental learning. So as you have very complicated tasks, it might be impossible for a model to solve it right away, and you might need to provide tasks of increasing complexity. The same way as you cannot expect that kid, that if you ask a kid to solve integrals, that the kid will, or like a 6 years old, to solve integrals, if you would give him thousands of books. The same way our model might need at first to learn elementary operations before jumping to more difficult problems. So here, in case of three rows addition, we actually were not able to solve it without curriculum. So what I mean by that, if we would generate the grid with completely random numbers, then the model was not able to learn how to add them. But instead, we actually generated numbers that are full of zeros, full of small numbers, so they won't require carry and so on. So here are a few examples. You can see one example is add 1 plus 2 plus 2, or add 2 plus 0 plus 2, and so on. And here there are still a lot of zeros in these problems. And then over the time, when it comes to longer sequences, we actually put all possible digits, and we haven't simplified. So the only during training we simplify examples. Here is the table of our performance, and let me explain what is here. So at the very left we enumerated tasks. So that's copying, reverse, walk, two row addition, three row addition, and single digit multiplication. At the very top we specified the configuration of the models. And then percentage means how often out of 10 runs model succeeds on long sequences. So let's look carefully what we have over here. So first question is regarding the model size. So as I mentioned, actually it might be harder to solve these problems when the model is big. And we can see it's a model that has 600 units, 400 units, and later on we actually test our models on 200 units. And you can see that even copying, when you have huge number of units, might fail. Two rows addition works worse, three rows addition doesn't work. So you can see that in case of bigger models, it's actually harder to train on such tasks. So Then second of all, the next four columns, they actually speak about the use of dynamic discount. So you can have a fixed discount of 1. You can have a fixed discount of 99% or 95%. Those are discounts that usually people consider. Then you can use dynamic discount. And you can see that pretty much on copying we have the best performance. Then on two-row addition, actually, it's a little bit worse than the previous one. On three rows addition is, let's say, in pair with some of them, but not with discount one. But then all of a sudden, we can completely solve multiplication task while other models, they were failing on it. Additionally, we use Watkins Q lambda. So that's the technique that I described, that it can counteract the fact that we have non-stationary environment. And all of a sudden, we have many more 100% in our model. Then we use one more technique called we add some penalty term in order for Q values to take distinct values, because if the values are close to each other, you might randomly you might end up choosing one or another, but to have some margin. I haven't described it carefully, and that's essentially this third row to the end. So you can notice that, that in case of reverse, with the classical LSTM, we're never able to solve it. In the sense, classical LSTM, so has a it or the, like also with GRU, and I played a little bit with classical recurrent nets as well. I was not able to solve this problem, and in the sense, it's because even if model would go to very end of sequence, then it's kind of easier to pull information from memory and reverse the sequence in memory. So you can imagine that the model can memorize entire sequence, just go to the very end, and revert it completely in memory. But the problem is that this strategy won't generalize to longer sequences. And the model actually pretty much always ends up learning such a strategy. Then if we would just replace LSTM with controller that actually has no memory about the past, that's the feed-forward controller, then all of a sudden you can easily get 100% accuracy. The problem with feedforward controller is that obviously you can just solve some constraint problems. So you won't be able to solve all the problems with feedforward controller. Like addition is impossible to solve with feedforward controller because you have to remember carry. The very last two columns, that's actually performance if we test it on the length way longer, so 1,000. So the point over here is actually the penalty term that I haven't described that much. Actually, it helps to generalize to way, way longer sequences because it makes actions to be very distinct. So the only difference between last two columns is that in one case there is penalty term and in another there is no. And you can notice that in case of penalty term, then you have you achieve generalization to way longer sequences. So right now, I will speak about my previous work that was work from Google, where we played with different algorithm called Rainforce to solve similar tasks. Also as an extra thing, we're playing with external memory. But about it later. So first of all, what's the objective of Rainforce? So in case of Q learning, the goal was to learn what's the sum of future rewards. And then from it, we're actually computing policy. And policy was induced as the argmax. And in this case, in case of reinforce, actually, we are directly learning policy. So reinforce, the objective is that, let's say P, that's the policy that we want to learn. The objective is a probability of the sequence of actions multiplied by the sum of rewards that we would get for it. And the objective, that's the this objective consists of a sum over all possible sequences of actions. So obviously, as you have to consider sum over all possible sequences of actions, this quantity is intractable. But actually, it can be accessed through sampling. So you can sample according to probability P, and then just experience sum of rewards. And we can differentiate this quantity. So in this work, actually, our reward was differentiable. Reward was exactly equal to log likelihood of prediction. So as you differentiate the quantity from the previous page, then the derivative actually hits both policy and it hits the reward. But once again, we would like to, we don't want to sum over all possible actions because this sum is intractable, but we can access it through sampling. So first of all, we use one of the identities. So P prime, and that applies to any function, is actually equal to P times logarithm of P prime. So that's what we substitute in the first equation. And then all of a sudden, we can express once again the equation at the top, the equation for the derivative, in terms of sampling. So once again, there is a way to access this quantity through sampling. So we train this model with SGD, as usually. We used curriculum learning for our problems, and it was quite critical to use it. Otherwise, we were not able to actually solve our problems. And I would say it was quite challenging to train. And one of the main reasons is there is a lot of variance. So you can imagine, as you are sampling actions, then that can then you might have a lot of variance in your estimates. So here are some of the tasks. So let's say one task is a copy. So that's the task that was considered before. So you have tape with symbols. You start in the left, at the very left, and you're supposed to copy all the symbols. So here the solution is you're supposed to go to the right and just copy whatever you see, produce on the output tape the symbols that you have seen. And another task is duplicated input. So input appears multiple times, let's say appears three times in this case. So you have 7, 7, 7, 4, 4, 4. You're supposed to just output single 7 and then make three moves to the right, output single 4, and so on. Here is a task reverse. We have seen it before. Essentially, you have to go to the very end and then come back and produce the symbols that you see. And there are a few others. I will describe them in a second. So here is the execution trace from duplicated input. So how to read it? The time actually goes from the top to the bottom. The both columns correspond to different tapes. So the left column, that's the input tape, and the right column is the output tape. And the first row describes what the content of the what's the, let's say, in case of input tape, what's the entire content of the input tape. In case of output tape, what we would like to see on the output tape. And and as I mentioned, time goes from the top to the bottom. So first, the model sees the single W, and then it produces the symbol saying, oh, I'm not having any prediction. then it made a move to the right, and then it produced a symbol W. And that's why there is a W marked with green. That was the correct symbol. Then it made the move once again to the right and produced a hash saying, oh, nope, I'm not ready to make a prediction. Then again, it made to the a move to the right over the input tape, and it made said, I'm not ready to make a prediction once again, and then it produced the number 6. So you can see that actually it can perfectly solve the duplicated input problem. Here is instance of reverse. So once again, it's like a model starting the very left side and then goes to the very end and to the very right and then to the very left. So first it produces the symbol saying that I'm not ready to make a prediction, and then it starts reverting all the symbols. Here is the task called repeat copy. So repeat copy is like a copy, but you are asked to actually copy your symbols multiple times. So so first character tells you how many times you're supposed to copy. So it's 3 over here. And then you are asked to repeat the sequence 3 times. So you can see that the solution is go to the right, copy whatever you see, then suppress prediction and go to the left, and then once again copy whatever you see, suppress prediction, go to the left, copy whatever you see, and you're done. So it was able to solve this problem. So as I mentioned, actually, we also managed to give the to add the memory interface, and memory is actually discrete with access. So most of the memories that people consider out there, they are continuous, and then it means that they are not that efficient, because you have to access entire memory at every single time. In this case, we use reinforcement learning to decide where to look. So you have three actions to either, let's say, go left, right, or stay in the same position. However, you store inside of memory a vector of values, and then you can read this entire vector. And we can backpropagate through the content in memory, but we use reinforce to decide where to look. Okay, so here is instance of reverse with memory. So in this case, we actually force model that it has to go to the right on the input tape. So then it cannot go to the left. And you can see here is in the middle, there is memory access pattern. So so that's the location where it's in memory. Model says there's some multidimensional vector. It's unclear what is stored there. The model has to store there somehow the values that it sees, but that's those are just the real values. So we can see that as the model goes to the right, it starts saving in memory all the content. So you can see location where it saves in memory, and then as it hits the end of sequence, it starts reading from memory and producing corresponding symbols. So I would say that was actually we're quite excited to get it work, but in the sense it was very difficult to make a model to work with such a memory in such a setup. So I would say we have to figure out the more robust ways of training such models. And here is an example of repeat copying. So repeat copy means that you should copy whatever you see multiple times. So for instance, one of the solutions was here. But in the case of memory, once again, we force model to go to the right. So we hope that the model will save content in memory, but that's not what happens. And you can actually even notice, so it does the good job at the first pass, so it's able to produce the one copy of the symbols, but then it's not able to copy it again. And here it's supposed to copy it twice. And also you can see that memory access pattern doesn't make any sense, that it's meaningless. So also, as we were developing the RLNTM, we actually figured we had a need to even verify correctness of gradients. So in case of the neural networks which are deterministic, it's quite simple to verify correctness. You can do gradient checking. But here the problem is how to verify stochastic algorithms. So this algorithm consists of sampling, that you are choosing your action according to your policy, and how could you even check that your derivatives are computed correctly. So I wrote down what the proper equation for derivatives is at the very bottom. But you can imagine that as you are building your elaborate system, then there will be many places where you are choosing actions and so on, and it's unclear if you actually if you derive everything correctly. So how to even check the derivatives, how to verify stochastic algorithm? So one obvious idea is maybe you should just sample actions many times and compare them to average gradient to average of the numerical gradient. But one of the issues with it is actually sample complexity. So in order to get some precision, to get some confidence, you want, for instance, your error error be of the order of magnitude 10 to the minus 4 or 10 to the minus 5. Like you want the error to be tiny, but then you would need millions of samples. And it would mean that actually you probably need to even run it in a distributed setting or so. So we are thinking about it quite a bit, but I was not brave enough to write it this way. Instead, actually, we came out with more practical way of doing it. So you can see that here I just wrote what's the schema behind the reinforce, and I will explain the relation to gradient checking. So in case of reinforce, you can see it works in the way that agent samples actions according to probability, and then actions are executed in the environment. So environment is at the very right, that's the tree, and then you are getting some rewards from it. And so you are looping between sampling actions and actually executing them in environment. Then as you are done with your episode, you accumulate your rewards, and then the rule tells us how to backpropagate. That's what happens in case of reinforce. And in order to actually verify gradients, we are saying make your mini batch as big as all possible actions, and actually you can, in order to do it, you essentially create extremely tiny environment, and then for every row of mini batch, you're actually returning the corresponding sequence of actions, and then so here we actually replaced sampling. So there was a sampling according to given probability distribution. We replace it with deterministic sequence, and here we are enumerating all possible sequences. And from engineering perspective, it's the best to put it into single mini batch. And then we said, as you have a sum of rewards, it's enough just to multiply it by the value behind the sampling, the value of the probability. So in the sense, there are two differences. We deterministically take the sequence. Of course, the environment has to be extremely tiny. And second of all, sum of future rewards is multiplied by the weight corresponding to the probability of this sequence. So I would say for us, it was actually quite critical to implement reinforce, because initially, as we implemented this model, we thought that that it's correct, but it was not, and it still took us 1 week or so to find how to fix it in order to pass gradient checking. And I will say, without gradient checking, we wouldn't know that we have some errors, some bugs. Also, it's important that the action space is actually small, because you have to enumerate all possible sequences of actions. And such implementations takes 2 seconds maybe to actually verify gradients on the laptop. And in case if you would do sampling in order to verify, it would you would need many machines and a lot of computation. So one last thing that I want to mention is, in case of rainforest, actually one of the problems is that there is a variance in gradients. And one idea that's the quite common idea is to subtract the baseline reward. So it means, so in the sense, network tries to first anticipate how much reward it can achieve, and then as it executes a sequence of actions, if the sequence is above the baseline, then it tries to reinforce these actions. If it's below such baseline, that then it's discouraged. A kind of analogy might be in the real life. So let's say someone is making $1 million every month. Then this person is expecting to make $1 million, and then if this guy would make $500,000, then because it's below the expected reward, then such a guy would be upset. The same time as you have someone on the street who makes almost no money, and then such a person would get $100, then it would make this guy very happy because he's above the baseline. So in the sense that ultimate reward is equal to whatever you accumulated minus the expected reward. And mathematically, you are actually completely allowed to do it, and in expectation you will get the same results. It's because, let's say, sum of probabilities over all the actions is equal to 1. The derivative of it is equal to 0, because derivative of 1 is equal to 0. So you are allowed to subtract the quantity from second row whenever you want. And essentially, baseline the constant, it's multiply exactly with the with quantity p log p prime, which is exactly p prime. So in terms of the things that are interesting to me as the future work, there is several of them. So first of all, I would like to solve, obviously, more complicated problems. That's hard. Maybe we'll need some improvements of our algorithms. So, for instance, I would like to be able to solve problems that require more than n steps. I want to say that actually recently there is one model that it's able to solve a problem that requires n squared number of steps, like a multiplication. That's the model by Ilya Suskaver and Łukasz Kaiser, and they solve multiplication. I would like to be able to not only have a memory that is used to solve a given task, so you can see that in case of our memory, that's the memory that is used for the given task, like that you store in memory intermediate results, and then you reuse them later. But I would like to have a persistent memory in which you can store, for instance, entire algorithms. And obviously, in order to solve very difficult problems, we'll need to have entire family of tasks, and we'll have to do lifelong learning. So I think that Thomas will speak much more about these topics. And this work actually, so I just described two of my papers. So one of them was I wrote it with Ilya at Google, and one of them with Rob Fergus, Thomas, and Armon. at Facebook. I would like to thank them a lot for their collaboration. And I think it's time for questions. So here are the links to publications at the bottom. Actually, for both of the problems, I put the code online. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Okay, thank you, Wojciech. It was a very interesting lecture. So, questions, please.
Hello. Thank you for a very interesting talk again. I have a simple, very simple question. You see, you say that there is an issue that we might have a system with the discrete memory or with the continuous memory. Mm-hmm. And if we have reinforcement learning, this is the case of the discrete memory. So why does it perform better on the number of tasks than the system with continuous memory, let's say LSTM with several layers, with recurrent network, and so on? What's the intuition for?
Okay. First of all, one of the reasons why you might want to choose discrete memory is that theoretically, it might be way more efficient from computational point of view. In the sense, when you have continuous memory, you have to touch entire memory. And in case of discrete memory, you are touching just a single cell. It's kind of similar. Try to imagine how slow would be computer if every time when you are about to, let's say, add two numbers from RAM, you would need to read entire RAM. Then it would be kind of not of that huge use. Second of all, I would say that from optimization perspective, actually it seems that it's way easier to optimize continuous values rather than the discrete one. I wouldn't say that we perform better than actually using then models that use continuous memory, in the sense, I wouldn't say so. I mean, it's actually not properly compared. There is no well-established family of tasks for such a problem. It's more of that still we are at such an early stage that it's so difficult to actually even make any of these tasks to solve these problems that people create tasks which are the most fitted to their particular problems. So it's not that you can even create a task that everyone would be happy to solve, because these models, they still really can solve barely the simplest problems. And last of all, one of the fundamental reasons why you might want to play with discrete memory or like with discrete interfaces is to explore how to train discrete interfaces. So what I mean by that, many of models many of tools that the human is using are actually indeed discrete. So for instance, as we have a database stores the values and allows a discrete access to the to content inside, and it might be way better to be able to train a neural network to interact with our tools, for instance, to interact with a database and to figure out how to store and load information from database, rather than to expect neural network to store it all internally, or let's say how to use Google search engine or so. So it would be strange to have a need to build search engine for a organisms. As humans, they are able to learn using discrete interface like Google. So it would be super cool if computer would be able to actually walk around the Google and decide what to read and so on. Yeah, I think that's the answer. Hello? Hello?
Hi. I have a quick question about one of your slides. So could you get back to this picture with memory access? I think it was, what is it, reverse with memory?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's the one. So could you comment on this position where the memory access on the way back seems to be at the same position, but you output different symbols, the correct ones?
Yeah, so you can notice that actually it advanced already three steps. And I think that first of all, it advanced few steps ahead. I would say we can look carefully in this picture. I think that potentially in the last, so it's also a question, because there might be things might be offsetted by one. The question is, what is seen at the given position? But there is actually few possibilities here. One possibility is that really at this position, because it's actually staying in the same position for two time steps, it might be that the things are offsetted by one and still there is necessary information in memory. So the question is about if the number 3 was stored in memory, that there is like it should retrieve character A, G, B, 3. So the question is if 3 was stored in memory, or maybe it just helped itself and maybe remembered before the number 3 or so. You can, either way, you can take the code and play with it and see what is in memory, or you can more carefully look at this picture. I think that it might be the case that as it's actually predicting stuff, it might be one off. So it's already in the memory position for G when it's actually outputting A. Then it's already in the position for B in memory when it outputs G. And then it's in position for 3 when it stays in memory.
More questions?
Yes, could I continue on the previous question? So currently the memory seems quite simple, but if, let's say, we use Wikipedia, or if we search through Google, would there be a fundamental change in behavior? Because sometimes we as humans, when we input a query, then we decide, oh, this is not what we want in the result, we need to change the query, again to input the query, and so on. So we need some fundamental change in this system. Thank you.
I would say, okay, like in terms of basic components, it's theoretically possible just to take whatever is there and then plug Google search engine or Wikipedia, but in reality I would say I'm quite sure that it won't work at the first time. So you can imagine that the action space for Google search is actually extremely huge. You cannot just start typing A, AB, BA, ABC, and so on, and then to get little bit of reward. In the sense, in order to solve some problem, you have already to start typing something meaningless. So the question is, how to give model enough knowledge to actually type something meaningless and to, let's say, choose appropriate links and so on. So I would dream of actually solving such a problem. Of course, such a memory has such an interface gives a lot of capabilities, and I would say I envision that the future systems, for instance, people try to train neural networks to answer informations, to do question answering, as in case of hackathon, and you can store a lot information inside of the neural network. My question is, would it be possible for neural network to answer all these questions rather than knowing the answer, knowing how to search? So let's say, if you would ask me what's the age of President Obama, even though, or if you would ask any human, people wouldn't know the answer, and very few people would know the answer. But if you would allow someone to search online, then pretty much everyone can find the answer. So I'm kind of in favor, but that's, let's say, something like a long-standing. I'm in favor of systems that internally they have quite elementary knowledge about the world, but then they try to actually offset all the not that important information to more permanent data sources like a database, or just to go online on Wikipedia and find it online.
More questions? No. Okay, let's thank Wojciech.
Okay, great. Okay.